We're going to reconvene the April 3rd, 2012 meeting of the Brattleboro Select Board. We know that the meeting's been officially warned. The first item on the agenda is approval of the minutes. First minutes we have for consideration are those from March 20, 2012. Do we have a motion?
I move to approve the minutes from March 20th, 2012.
Are there any comments, suggestions, changes to those minutes? Dora?
I have a couple. On page 3, just to make sure that there's clear language separating all of the three entities that we're talking about, because the curbside pickup has nothing to do with the Solid Waste Management District, and so I just have Jane Southworth and Nancy Barber were present to discuss the proposal for curbside pickup and the pilot program to begin with 150 households. By Triple T. And then another sentence that says Bobulus and Southworth reported that Wyndham Solid Waste Management District is looking at doing a composting operation at the district.
Dory, you're
so right. I can give that language to Jen. So and then in the on line 46 for the motion on the SBAP loan, just that Chapman isn't an abstention, it's a recusal, and there's a difference in how that's viewed.
Yes, Chapman recused himself, that's fine.
Mm-hmm. All right, so we have changes that Dora's suggesting in the paragraph relating to the solid waste contract?
Yes.
And then we would change language on line 46 to Chapman had recused himself. Any other changes suggested? Anybody have any concerns about adding those changes? All right. Hearing nothing further, all those in favor of adopting the minutes of March 20, 2012 as amended, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed? All right. The next matter on the agenda would be the minutes from March 28, 2012. Anybody have any comments, changes, suggestions?
First, I'll move to approve the minutes from March 28, 2012.
Thank you, Ken. Any comments, changes, suggestions? Hearing none, all those in favor of adopting those minutes, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Anybody opposed? That motion carries 4-0. Next item on the agenda is the chair's remarks. With Dick DeGray out of town today, making the chair's remarks falls to me. I was looking forward to making comments about some of the building blocks that we've seen put in place for the town's activities over the next year. And I still get to speak about those, but we've also had some other matters that we're going to have to talk about a little bit tonight and that will impact us going forward. First off, this is our first meeting following town meeting. And I want to thank all the town meeting members for attending and for everybody's hard work and effort. Over that long town meeting a week and a half ago, we have taken steps as a select board to begin addressing goals. We had two special meetings over the course of the last week, and we have an agenda item tonight to address the goals that we're going to be working on over the course of the next year. Also, I would note that we had the groundbreaking for the Union Station project last week. And if anybody has not yet had the opportunity to head over towards Hinsdale, there's a completely different vista looking over at the mountain and looking over at New Hampshire. Probably we haven't had that vista in more than 100 years. How long has the Gasworks building been there?
More than
100 years. So everybody's encouraged to make your way over towards New Hampshire. We've got a completely different view downtown, and that's really very exciting to see the development that's going to be going on down there. Also, we had some very good news this week relating to the Brooks House. There was the press conference earlier today that there are people who are going to be setting up a corporation with the intent of purchasing that building from its current owner and raising the funds to rehabilitate that structure. And there's been some interest that's been expressed, although there's nothing clearly in place for the downtown college campus that the governor has spoken about, and hopefully we'll see some growth and development at the Brooks House over the course of the coming years through that new business structure that's been developed. Those are really exciting things, but I think most of us are aware also about the vandalism and the property destruction and the criminal conduct that we were faced with on Friday evening, although there aren't any specific figures that I've heard with any clarity. It's our understanding that there was damage ranging from $250,000 to $1 million worth of damage. Fires that were set all over town on Friday night, and just terrible property destruction and vandalism. It's really just unexplainable that somebody could, or a group of people could, engage in that conduct. We want to thank the Brattleboro Police Department and the Vermont State Police for their prompt and effective investigation work. I want to thank the chief for the work of the department in finding the people who we believe were responsible for that course of criminal conduct. We also want to thank the fire department for all of their work keeping people safe. One of those fires was, as I understand it, very close to some gas tanks, and there could have been much more destruction that could have occurred. I would note that, as we understand it at this point, the perpetrators are juveniles, age 13, 14, and 15. That's what I've seen from press accounts. And although we would like, over the course of the coming months, to see some public accountability and to see some public response to the conduct that we suffered on Friday night, I think everybody should understand that because of the nature of the criminal justice system and the juvenile justice system, we may not hear anything going forward about consequences that may be happening or about what's happening with the perpetrators of that course of criminal conduct. And we'll hear more about that from the press, but I can't really promise everybody public accountability for those things that occurred on Friday night because they're within the criminal, within the juvenile justice system. What I can promise is that the town and the select board, to the extent that we are involved, will do whatever we can to support those businesses that suffered losses and damages as a result of what occurred on Friday night. I also want to take a moment right now to extend our condolences to our accountant, Brenda Breyer, who suffered a death in her family. And so I'm just going to take a moment of silence. Thank you. The next item on the agenda is the town manager's comments.
I have none.
All right. Select board committee reports. Are there any select board committee reports? Dora?
I have a couple things. One is last week I went to the conference for the Vermont Association of Composters, connected to my position on the planning committee with the Solid Waste District. And we have made some good connections in furthering the possibilities of doing composting operation over there. But also, one of the workshops that I went to was people, organizations and solid waste districts reporting on their composting operation, their composting pickup services. And so many, we're really on the cutting edge here of what we're talking about doing with Triple T, and it's really exciting to see the closest thing that comes to what we're doing as far as the curbside pickup is a small bicycle operation up in Burlington that picks up compost from some residences. I think they service, you know, a few dozen households. So we should be really excited on what we're doing, because everything else is commercial and things similar to Project Cow, where people drop it off, and so that was really exciting. And I just want to on Friday, the Senate Economic Development and General I can never remember what it's called, General Affairs Committee from the state came down and did hearings on economic development. The post VY Task Force, as well as Southern Vermont Economic Development Group, reported out on their findings. And a number of different citizens and organizations and businesses from around the Wyndham county region reported out, and I really, it was really exciting to hear some of the projects that are in place and some of the ideas that are coming out of our region. And so I have a lot of hope for economic development in the future. I was going to ask Barb if she wanted to add anything about that, but she's walking away.
No. I just asked her to move the board because
the sun is shining
right in my eyes.
and then I just want to say that I participated in the Safe and Green march 2 weeks ago on Vermont Yankee, and I just want to say that I couldn't be prouder of our community. The way that the march, the organizers for the march, and how well organized it was in three different locations, and marching, walking down Putney Road, and our police department, our fire department, the Vermont State Police, the Sheriff's Department, all the support personnel, I guess the DPW must have been involved in it too. I just couldn't be prouder of our community, and I just want to say that our Brattleboro Police Department, the officers, they conducted themselves in such a great way. It really says a lot about our community to have those kind of relationships and interactions between community members and our police department. So I just want to say thank you to them because it was really nice to see.
And I want to apologize to Dora for the noise that we were making, putting that board up there.
It takes a village.
That it does. Thanks, Barb, for helping. Any other committee reports from board members? I would briefly report on the Traffic Safety Committee meeting. We are going to have an update later on in the agenda on traffic safety-related steps that we're taking. But we did have a very healthy Traffic Safety Committee meeting last Tuesday morning. It was very well attended by residents in town, including people from near Memorial Park and near Academy School, indicating concerns that they've got about the speed of traffic. There has been a lot of press. I want to thank the Reformer for covering the issue regularly. I think it's very clear that it's only by increasing public awareness about the risk of unsafe driving that we're going to protect all of us. So we'll talk about that a little bit more, but there was a very healthy Traffic Safety Committee meeting as well. Not hearing any more Select Board Committee reports, we'll open up for public participation. This is the opportunity for anybody who's come to the meeting this evening to speak to the board and to the public about an item that's not on the agenda. Remind me of your name. I'm sorry. I've seen you here many times, but
it's Gary Snyder.
Gary Snyder. Gary, do you want to speak during public participation?
Yes.
All right. Why don't you go ahead?
Can somebody hand him the microphone, maybe?
Oh, I have a big enough voice.
Well, we need it for the
Michael?
TV audience.
Hey, Michael, can somebody take the handy other one?
Thank you, Maria. Gary, go ahead.
I think
it's turned
on here.
It is.
Is it
live? It is. Can you hear me? I am Gary Snyder. I am on the ADA Advisory Board for the town of Brattleboro. I'm also on the Board of Directors for the VCIL. Questions. Why wasn't anybody on the ADA Advisory Committee told about this meeting concerning traffic safety and general pedestrian safety? Second, I made a phone call to the town clerk's office 2 weeks ago to have some real bad potholes filled in Harmony parking lot. 2 weeks ago, they still haven't been done. And I'd like to know why. You know, people shouldn't have to worry about walking around Harmony parking lot falling in potholes that are 2 feet wide and 6 inches deep. Also, in regards to the new project for the Brooks Building. That is going to be ADA compliable, right? Because seeing as how it's going to be refurbished under ADA rules, it has to be handicap accessible. So I just wanted to put that little fly in your soup.
Thanks. Barb, if you could please address issues relating to the notice for traffic safety and the potholes in Harmony Lot, and if you can,
sure.
the ADA compliance as well.
Traffic safety is a regular meeting. They meet on the Tuesday morning, the fourth Tuesday of the month. It's 8:30, and it's a regular meeting that we warn just like the ADA committee meetings. It's going to be on the agenda, I would guess, for a while. So the fourth Tuesday of the month at 8:30 right in here. We're all going to come, but it was warned like all the other meetings. Actually, it was warned more because of the week before that we had a select board meeting where I talked about what we were going to be talking about at the Traffic Safety Committee. The Harmony Lot, my understanding is that is a work order that's been placed in Public Works. And I'm not sure where they're at with patching holes, Rick. I don't know if...
We have been out the hot lots. I don't know if they've been there, but I'll find out more.
Okay.
No, they haven't been there.
Well, I do know it is that there's a work order for it, that when it got called in, there is a work order that was created in Public Works for it. And as far as ADA compliance with the Brooks House, I would assume that they would meet whatever requirements there are. I don't know how it would differ for historic buildings, as there are some things with historic buildings, but that would be a private undertaking that I would assume would be compliant.
Okay. Gary, I think it's fair to say that the plans for rebuilding the Brooks House are in very early stages, mm-hmm. and we only heard today that there's a new corporate structure that's going to work on trying to raise money for that. So hopefully as that process unfolds, you'll make sure to continue to have your voice heard. You know, that's really
yes.
important. I know you
yes.
will.
Brian and knows me real well.
Yeah, we'll look forward to hearing from you some more about that.
I just wanted to say, Gary, it might be a good idea if the advisory committee gets together and has one person attend those traffic safety meetings over the next couple of months, since they're going to be speaking a lot about the pedestrian issues.
Okay. Yeah, well, we weren't, nobody on the committee was notified about this meeting.
I understand that, you know, but the traffic safety committee is sort of a regularly meeting, so it might have been I think better communication between committees if there's going to be some sort of, you know, if there's going to be like issues, it might be a good idea. But I would just suggest to you as a committee member to bring back to your committee that you guys might want to take turns going to those meetings for a while.
Every last Tuesday of the month, every fourth Tuesday of the month, 8:30 here.
Okay.
All right. Thank you, Gary. Anybody else here and want to participate in public participation? maybe Howard will take the mic and hand it to Maria. Thank you. The next item on the agenda is liquor commissioners. Do we have a motion to enter into liquor commissioners?
I will move that we enter into a meeting of liquor commissioners.
Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. That motion, anybody in opposition? That motion carries 4-0. The first item under liquor commissioners is liquor license renewals. Barb, if you could please outline the liquor license renewals that we're here to consider today.
Tonight before the board, there are six renewals. Gillies, McNeil's Brewery, and the McNeil's that's on Elliott Street, as well as the brewery down at Brown Court, Sportsman's Lounge, the Tavern, and Vermont Maple Museum. The board has in your packets A report from the chief of police, Gene Wren, as well as a report from the town clerk that also has violations from the state. And as was noted in the memo from the town clerk, there are two establishments that one is behind in utilities and one is behind in an SBAP loan or small business assistance loan. If the board does not find any have any other issues with those two establishments, it would be our recommendation that those are approved pending that the two establishments either come up to date or enter into a payment agreement with the town.
Does anybody on the select board have any comments or want to speak to these six liquor license renewal applications?
I think it's a good suggestion from Barb.
I would agree.
Well, if there's no further comment from the select board, maybe we can get a motion on the table and then we'll see if there's any comments from the public.
Talk to me.
I would move in accordance with Ms. Sondag's suggestion that we renew this license subject to satisfaction of business license renewals and satisfaction of any past due utilities and satisfaction of any past due amounts on small business assistance program loans.
We have a motion. Is there any discussion from anybody who's in attendance tonight? These six establishments, again, Gillies, two for McNeil's, Sportsman's, the Tavern, and Vermont Maple Museum. No discussion? Yes, sir. Please identify yourself and speak.
Bill Knowles. I'm glad you gave me the opportunity. This might sound kind of petty, but when we open up a bar, yeah, go ahead. When we open up bars, I see that the streets get awfully messy really quick. I noticed the last bar that was open that I cleaned up the streets, the cigarette butts, and there's thousands of them around the bars. Now, they're everywhere in town, but around the bars, on the sidewalks, on the street, trash being blown everywhere. And I wish, I know it sounds petty, but I wish there was a policy saying that if you own a liquor license, you're responsible to clean out the front of your store at closing. Not the next day when you open, at closing, because it's pretty horrible. And today, it's horrible. I mean, the cigarette butts are everywhere. Nobody's been cleaning up at all. I've been laid up, so I haven't been able to do it. And I'm not supposed to do it. I just do it because I can't stand looking at the trash. Right now, the trash is blowing up and down Main Street. We're talking how wonderful certain parts of our city is working. And I like that. I like to hear how wonderful we're doing. But let's talk about the trash. Let's talk about the things that aren't going right, the stuff going on in the city that I hope that some of us know about that are below the law. And I know everybody's cringed when they said the 1% tax. And the first thing that comes to my mind is, we don't have enough police officers, and I hope nobody in the room says we do, because we don't. And we need more qualified police officers and more police cars, probably. And let's stop hiding from this 1%. I don't even know what the 1% is all about. But if it would go to the police department, I'd love it.
Thank you, Mr. Knowles. Barb, maybe you could speak briefly about the responsibility that establishments downtown have for cleaning up the sidewalks?
Actually, there is a requirement in the ordinance for bars to have containers outside to place cigarette butts. And I will make a suggestion to the town clerk that a reminder of that go out to each of the establishments when their permits come in.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anybody else have any comments about the motion to approve these liquor license renewals as conditioned? Well, hearing none, all those in favor of the motion to approve liquor license renewals for these six establishments, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed? That motion carries 4-0. The next item on the agenda is an application for a second class liquor and tobacco license for MP Goen Company, Inc. I understand Mr. Goen is here, and so maybe you'd like to come up to the table and tell us about your application.
Good evening.
Hi.
I'm in the process of opening a neighborhood store at my residence on Guilford Street. And I've been through the process with the DRB, and all the steps have been complete to date. And now I'm looking for approval for a second-class alcohol and tobacco license for that store.
Maybe you could describe to us a little bit where the property is located and where in the building you're going to be, you want to put this store.
The property is at 500 Guilford Street, which is just as you crest the hill across the road from the High Point development. The building that I'm using is a 1,400 square foot garage that I used to use for my other businesses that I'm using half of that now for a store, and the other half is going to be an apartment.
And what are you planning to offer in the business, the establishment, besides cigarettes and alcohol, if anything?
Regular neighborhood store type stuff, milk, bread, ice cream, all the things that you'd find in a store like Western Ave Grocery or Hoosier's Market or of that nature.
Could you tell us about what other permits you've had to get and where you stand now?
Right now, I've been through the conditional use for the development review board, the site plan approval. That's all been approved. Been through the appeals period. The only permit I have left to get is after talk. I mean, I have to get a change of use with the fire safety, Vermont Fire Safety, which is just a more or less a technicality. In talking with Brian Johnson.
Thank you. Anybody on the board have any comments or questions about this application? Ken?
Can you speak to why you would want to sell alcohol and cigarettes?
Just another thing to sell in a store that all stores sell. Just add to the profit margin.
And how would you advertise? What kind of advertising? I can't picture
that. I'm not going to do any advertising other than the 6-square-foot sign that the town's going to let me put on the building.
No signs in windows or anything like that?
Not that I don't have any windows on the road, so no. Nope.
Any other questions from any members of the board?
I'm wondering if we could hear from the public. I have concerns myself, and I'd like to hear what the public has to say.
I just want to make sure that anybody from the board's got any more comments or anything.
I can make a comment.
Yeah, please comment your questions.
Tipping my hand and saying it's really difficult for me to support this. This is a rural residential neighborhood. Its proximity to a school could not be, short of being on school property, it's just right next to a school. And I think it's pretty consistent with what I've said and over the past year. I just have a real problem with moving the sale of alcohol and cigarettes even more towards a rural space in town that's not as policed, that's not as mainstreamed in terms of sight and visibility. So I don't have a problem tipping my hand and saying that for me, and consistency in what I've put out there over the past year, I couldn't possibly support this. It's not to say that I don't support, you know, the selling of milk. I'm specifically speaking to that this is coming under our role right now is convene liquor commissioners. Mm-hmm. I'm not speaking to any other aspect of your business right now. Proposed business.
Maybe before we open it up to public comments, if the chief could address any issues relating to enforcement as they relate to the location of the business or any other, or the proposed business, or any other issues.
No, the police department have no objection to the permit. I mean, if he applies for it, meets all the requirements. We patrol out there just like we patrol anywhere else.
Thank you. Sounds like we want to hear more comments from the public before a motion is made. Is that how the board wants to proceed? That's okay.
Well, we could make a motion and then entertain the comments from the public.
Why don't we do that?
That'd be tidier.
I'd prefer. Do we have a motion at this time to approve the second-class liquor license and tobacco license for MP Gohan Co. Inc., located at 500 Guilford Street.
I will make that motion.
All right, so that motion is now on the table. Does anybody who's in attendance want to speak to this application? Ms. Stearns.
I'm Bonnie Stearns, and I'm a neighbor. And I've looked at the map the town has of the locations of first-class and second-class liquor licenses, their geographical distribution around town. And it seems very clear to me, unless I'm misinterpreting anything, that all of the second-class licenses, in other words, all the alcohol carryouts, I guess you'd say, are on major thoroughfares, such as Route 9, Route 5. And it seems like this is a pretty obvious departure from that pattern. So I'm wondering whether there is any town philosophy is not the right word. There may not be a policy. There's probably not a rule, or else he wouldn't be applying. But is there any feeling within the town, perhaps the police department or the town, youth selectmen, is there any feeling that it's better to have alcohol not be sold in all kinds of other places? And is that starting a precedent?
Thank you. What I'm going to do before asking anybody else from the community to speak is I'm going to ask Ken maybe to summarize a little bit the discussions that were had by the ad hoc committee and to explain those criteria that were added into our procedures, because that's the closest thing that I can offer in response.
Yes. The criteria we added, except that it's not, I would preface it by saying it's not so close in response, even though it's as close as we can get. The criteria that we added were mostly focused on the training, of people serving alcohol, selling alcohol. We didn't make a resolution, and certainly didn't adopt any ordinance or rules about where these establishments are in town. I think we talked about it very briefly at our first meeting, and then moved on to other things. Also, because there are other establishments in town, it was kind of how do we grandfather in places that are already there, and looking at the whole picture. We didn't specifically look at only first-class or only second-class licenses. So we looked at how people are trained, providing a manual for training folks, the police reporting and the Department of Liquor Control reporting back on responding to violation notices, requiring that establishments respond to violation notices within a short amount of time, but didn't get at the geographical piece. But as we were just handed, and I'm looking at on my screen as well, I certainly would, in looking at the distribution of the first and second class liquor licenses in town, the way this looks is indeed that second class liquor licenses are on major thoroughfares.
And I would note that Barb Sondag, town manager, gave each of the board members a copy of that map that Barb was referring to, that Bonnie was referring to. And if anybody wants to look, we certainly can pass one around the room. So if somebody wants to come up and look, we can certainly pass that around. Anybody else who's in attendance want to speak to the application? Sir, please identify yourself.
Frank Klukin. I'm also a neighbor of where the liquor license is proposed. It just doesn't make sense that it is very close to the school. It is almost at the end of their driveway. And I have looked at the map, and it does seem out of place. One thing you'll notice on the map is the population density of the places that already have the first and second class liquor licenses. The proposed site is very rural. You can see by the lot size lines on the map that it just seems out of the blue, just seems totally out of place, and it doesn't make any sense to me.
Thank you. Anybody else here want to speak to the application? Can I come back to you before I get from people in the public? Anybody else here wants to speak to the application? Mr. Norton.
Bill Knowles from Brattleboro.
Knowles.
I was here last year. We were talking about giving a liquor license to what is it, Walgreens up there across from Price Chopper. It wasn't. What didn't we have? Okay, and wasn't it mentioned that there's a distance between the schools and where liquor can be sold, and there isn't.
Sadly, no.
Well, see, I left here last year, thinking that you made an exception to Walgreens to give them a license because they were already Price Chopper, too close to the high school, selling liquor. Is that so?
There's no
requirement in terms of distance for an establishment that sells liquor and how close or far away it has to be from a school.
Just a comment. That was a discussion that happened, but there was no law or ordinance that had a stated distance from the school. There was discussion because there were people advocating for not giving the liquor license because of its close proximity to the school, but we have no such ordinance that gives any criteria in that matter.
So no state, no liquor, no town.
No.
And no interest in making a law keeping the liquors and cigarettes away from it. No interest at all.
Well, I can't say that there's no interest. What I can say is that it's not in place now.
Okay.
And so the applicant's certainly got a right to have the current law applied to him.
I'm not worried about that. I'm just worried about the distance.
Sure. Go ahead, Mr. Cohen.
There is a, talking with Bill Manch, the state law is 200 feet. And from my driveway to halfway up the driveway to the school is about a third of a mile, about 3/10. That's halfway up the school's driveway.
Anybody else who's in attendance want to speak to the application?
Beth, did you want to talk? Do you need the mic?
No, I want the citizens who live around there to talk first. Go ahead.
Yeah.
I'll answer the questions about the ordinance, though, Mr. Olson.
Thank you, Beth.
I'm Ken Owings, and I'm also a neighbor. My concern has been right along is the traffic, both pedestrian and vehicular traffic. When we went through the DRB process, Mr. Gouin stated that he probably would be only getting 1 to 2 trucks per week delivery. I don't know how much beer he's planning on selling, but that adds to the traffic, whatever that is. The other concern that I have is pedestrian traffic, because the road is narrow right there. There's no shoulders. There's ditches on both sides of the road. The other thing that I got from Bonnie this morning was a study done about littering and trash around places that sell alcohol and tobacco. And I just really feel like, even though he's not, doesn't plan on having signs outside, the kids at the school and the kids in the neighborhood are subject to the demon alcohol and tobacco. And I just don't think that it fits in our neighborhood.
Thank you. Thanks. Do you want to speak as well? Ms. Rosen?
Mary Shea Rosen, and I'm a neighbor fairly close to Mr. Gouin's property. And I guess I'm thinking back to the conditional, and I'm maybe not correct on some of the terminology, but the conditional approval from the DRV. And what my recollection is that at that time that Mike had, when he was asked what population he thought he would serve, in the store it was primarily traffic from the school. So it just doesn't seem to make a lot of sense, or doesn't seem to click there. And I guess a secondary license is just the selling of alcohol. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Not serving of alcohol. The other point was that I believe seating was conditionally approved, up to 25 seats, for this very small neighborhood store, which he spoke of expanding outside. And the whole conditional approval in our neighborhood was, if not a first, new to our neighborhood, for the use of a convenience store. And I do know that several businesses, and I wish him the best, have come out of his personal property in our neighborhood, which is very rural residential. But I also, I have concerns or worries that if a secondary license is given now, will that turn into perhaps a bar in the future? I believe he owns a bar now. So I guess, you know, that's very subjective, but those are some of my concerns.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anybody else who's attending want to speak to the application? Mr. Schrader, you want to speak? Do you want to spring to the mic, or
no,
can you come up?
I'm halfway to recovery.
Good.
I want to address some of the issues that, especially Mr. Knowles' issue. BAPC, in an open letter with multiple organizations and most of the citizens' support, came before the Select Board in 2010 asking them to look at the density and the location via ordinance, via policy around location of second and first class licenses in relationship to schools and places where youth gather. There wasn't enough support for that at that time. And so that's probably what you're remembering. BAPC and all of these organizations came to a Select Board meeting asking them to take that up. That didn't happen. I'm hoping that this activity around, unfortunately, Michael's the recipient of this, this spurs you on to see that the citizens of this community are interested in how we license and where we locate these establishments. Some of the members of the community came to BAPC during the DRB process and during this process and asked for our assistance in educating them as to laws and rules and studies and all that sort of thing. There's lots of information out there that would tell you that violence, sexual assault of all kinds happen around liquor outlets. But that's really not the point here, although I can, you all have those packets I gave them and all that information to you. But the point is that there's people who live in this community, neighbors that are very concerned. And I think as we go through the town planning process, which has been moving along rapidly and excellently, that we need to think about these sort of things. And I also think that this whole idea of being close to a school is a huge issue, and I think that should be considered in this application. I'm not doubting that Michael would not do the best that he could for this business, but I also think that it doesn't fit into that neighborhood. But I also want to encourage all of us to not to participate in the town planning process and be involved so that your neighborhood is represented. I think that's a great, and the town has done an excellent job. I know my staff has gone to meetings, but I think that's something we need to think about. And I invite you all to be part of that process and work with BAPC on this issue. So thank you, and thank you for the citizens who came and spoke today.
Thank you, Beth. Is there anybody else who's in attendance who wants to speak to this application? Michael, I can give you another opportunity to speak now, or I can call on other board members. Maybe I'll call on other board members first, and then we'll give you a chance again. Ken?
So there are two possible outcomes. We vote for it or we don't vote for it. Can you explain, if we vote for it, that's pretty obvious where that goes. Can you explain, Barb, what happens if we, like, what is the process if the board does not approve the license before us?
It's not approved.
What recourse is available to the applicant?
For Michael? I don't know if there is a recourse. Chief, do you?
I don't know.
No, there is none. I don't believe we don't
no
have
appeals process.
Yeah, we don't have an appeals process.
Well, I wouldn't say for certain at this stage that there is no recourse, mm-hmm. because there may be available procedures, maybe in the civil courts dealing with challenges to board actions.
Right.
But it's really not for me to give legal advice or to speak to that at this point.
I wasn't asking you.
Well, I know. But,
yeah, well, and I should, yeah, and I should
there
say,
may well be.
There's not a, I am not aware that the board has a written appeals process as within your, either your rules of conduct or within the ordinance, but I could, you go get the book of ordinances for me, please.
I'll get back to you in a second, Bonnie. Dora?
Well, I was just going to say, he does have the right to come back with a new application, an amended application, a changed mm-hmm. application, the same
amended
application,
or
and, you know.
Mm-hmm. It has to be amended or changed.
Amended or changed.
Did you have anything to say?
Yeah, I think I should explain myself. I'm troubled by this this application. I've seen a number of communications from neighbors. The fact that other establishments are on at higher density locations, on major thoroughfares, where there's more vehicular and pedestrian traffic, and on roads where there are, for the most part, sidewalks. I guess the country club is an exception, but that's still got a big parking lot. That the population served could certainly be children, not the liquor, of course, and I would imagine it would be managed so that there wouldn't be an opportunity to purchase cigarettes. But I see a quality of life issue here for putting an establishment selling alcohol and cigarettes in a residential neighborhood rubs me the wrong way, frankly. I do not intend to vote to approve this for that reason.
I guess I'll call on myself and then we'll see if anybody else wants to speak. First off, I want to note for you that because you don't have all five board members here, you may have less of a chance of approval today than you might have another day, because a 2-2 tie doesn't give you your permit, but if there's another vote, you could lose 3-2 or 4-1 or 0-5, but you could also prevail 3-2. So we're going to give you the opportunity to request that the matter be brought up at a meeting where there's all five people here, if that's what you want. That's just a procedural matter. You know, I'm kind of two minds. There was a time when neighborhood stores were the rule, not the exception. And when I first moved here, you know, there was a store up on Chestnut Street, and that was in a little neighborhood, and they sold all kinds of things, ice cream and milk and beer too. And I don't know what the reaction would be from your neighbors if you were just offering milk and cereal and crackers and soda, but no beer and cigarettes. There's part of me that wants to say a neighborhood store is a good thing, but on the other hand, there's very substantial concerns that are being raised about the alcohol and the cigarettes being sold so close to the school. And so those concerns are things that I have to hear, because all your neighbors are saying them. So that's where I'm at right now. Anybody else who's in attendance want to speak to it? Ms. Stearns, did you want to say anything else?
I really had a question for the board in terms of procedure. The DRB is the only other town body that I'm familiar with the process. So, I think you've explained that he has the ability to come back and ask for approval at another time. What my question is: does the board need to vote yes or no, or is there something like? Other options, or what are the, what's the process, and also what criteria are you bound by?
First, I also wanted to say that I'm interested in seeing the permit from the Development Review Board, particularly given the suggestion that there might be seats that have been approved. So that's some information that I feel that I don't have yet, and that I haven't had a chance to look at. So my preference is to see the DRB permit and the site plan before making any final decision. That's additional information that I need. Bonnie, I think to just respond on that procedure, if this application goes to a vote tonight, or if it's tabled to a meeting where all five of us are here, and then it goes to a meeting, to a vote where there's five people and it's denied, he can submit an amended application at some point, but he can't submit exactly the same application back to us, I don't think. Would that be fair, Barb?
Yes.
And in terms of criteria, although I don't have the statute here, our discretion as liquor commissioners is like way broad. It's like it's got no rules associated with it at all, as I recall. And we asked for some guidance last year when we were doing these liquor license renewals. And the statute is very, very broad. But maybe Barb could speak to that issue briefly.
As far as the role?
Well, yeah, what is the role of the liquor commissioners?
You pretty much have whatever the board wants to enact as its own rules or to make decisions based on its own idea. What then happens is it goes up to, it's not the final approval, it then goes up to the Department of Liquor Control, and then they view it from the state's perspective. So at that point, you know, and that's, they are who issues the permit or the license. That license then comes down to the town clerk, who then gives the license to the applicant. That's one of the reasons that there's, you know, this is the first step in the granting of a liquor license. There is not necessarily within the town ordinances a way to appeal a denial of a license, and that's true of any license or permit if it gets denied. However, that doesn't mean that a license can't get changed or modified and then brought back.
Are there any further comments or questions at this time? I think that in fairness to the applicant, we should at least have a vote on whether we're willing to table this to a meeting where there's five people here to vote on the application, given that I've already heard some opposition from at least two members. So procedurally, I would move to table.
To
a date certain.
April 17th.
All right, so I'm just going to do that as board chair. Are you going to be here?
Yeah.
All right, so I move to
I can make the motion.
Table. I move to table this application and to continue its consideration on April 17th, 2012 at the select board meeting at that date. Is there any other discussion of that motion? Sir.
Maybe I'm thinking of this in the wrong way, but if there are a vote tonight and three people opposed tonight, wouldn't that be the same result as tabling till the 17th and having five people and those same three people opposing it then?
Very well might be.
Okay.
Just very well might be. Yeah. And if three people vote not to table, you know, then we'll go ahead tonight. Go ahead, Kim.
I'm confused. I think I'm confused a little bit because I'm thinking more broadly than this particular motion, but just about tabling anything where, for the reason that there are four of us and not five of us. And so now I'm not thinking just about this motion, but I'm thinking about the rest of our agenda. In a sense, with any of our votes coming up, if there's two opposing, then we would table because there's only four of us here. There are four of us here. I don't need to see, and again, I don't need to see the DRB piece, just I think the seating piece would be interesting, but for my purposes, it's still a liquor license in a rural residential neighborhood, so to me the seating piece, that we wouldn't be approving a permit about seating, that's not part of what we're looking at tonight.
Dora?
Well, I was just going to say, the other, if
and we can hear from the rest of the board about the tabling, because I'm fine with tabling it. I'd like to see the permit myself. But you also still have the option of withdrawing your application and not having it either voted, you know, so. So, you know, so if the board isn't amenable to the idea of tabling, that would be the other option.
Can I ask a procedural question?
Go for it.
What happens if there is a 2-2 tie?
If there's a 2-2 tie, it's voted down.
It fails.
And that's why, in my experience chairing at DRB, when we had people missing from time to time, when it was clear that there was a question about whether something was mm-hmm. going to pass simply because somebody was missing, we sometimes gave an opportunity to either table or to withdraw.
That was one of David Standard speeches when he was chair of the DRB.
For many years. Is there any further discussion at this time, Mr. Knowles?
Bill Knowles, I'm confused because you came to the table with no information. There was no tables. I mean, somebody second thought found out there was tables outside. Nobody mentioned the tables. When we were talking about having this, getting your license, the tables and the store itself wasn't even talked about. We didn't even know. I don't know. Did you people know what you were voting for? In other words, did you know there was going to be tables outside, or did you know any? Well, how can you make a vote on a liquor license when you don't have all the information? That's my question.
I'll respond briefly, and then Ken will as well. The application that's been filed is for a second-class liquor license, which does not provide for serving on premises, only for carry-out sales. The zoning board, the development review board, apparently granted a permit that included some tables, and I expressed some interest in looking at that. Ken, go ahead.
Can I ask why? I mean, I think that's the piece I'm still. It's one thing if we're tabling because there's only four of us here, but if we're tabling to see a permit, I'm just still trying to understand how that permit is relevant to the vote.
Conditional use approval as a zoning matter is based upon the proposition that the use is only a conditional use in the zone, is not a fully permitted use, and so there is a risk of adverse impact from having the use in the neighborhood. And the board is, the development review board is called upon to impose whatever conditions it deems appropriate in order to mitigate any adverse impact so that what would otherwise be a conditional use won't have an adverse impact in the rural residential neighborhood in this case. So because it was a conditional use, that means it's on the list of conditional uses in this rural residential neighborhood. It can be there, but it may adversely impact. And so the development review board had the right to condition the use to mitigate the adverse impact, and I want to see what they did and how they did it. Dora. Are you raising your hand?
No, I'm trying to let the people up in the control booth know that I'm getting reverb.
Yeah, same here. So that's why I was asking. Bonnie, I think we'll take that as the last comment.
Yes, very last comment. I just wanted to point out that there's at least one young person from the neighborhood here, and that probably some staff and parents from Hilltop Montessori School would have been here. People found out about this item on the agenda very late, and I'm not sure how one knows about these things. I missed that. But they have a curriculum night tonight, which involves the whole faculty and student body, parents, everything.
Well, I'm not going to call on the young person unless she wants to speak. All right. I think we're ready for a vote. So the motion is to table this matter to the meeting on April 17th, 2012. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, say nay.
Aye.
All right, so that motion carries 3-1. And we're going to take this matter back up at the meeting on April 17th. I would ask that the Development Review Board's decision and the site plan be distributed to us with the materials before the next meeting. Thank you, Mr. Coon.
Thank you.
And I want to thank everybody for coming and speaking to this matter. It's really important that everybody participate. The next matter on the agenda is a liquor license renewal application for Rocky Top Tavern. If you want to come to the table and identify yourselves, please.
They handed it. We had some materials they gave me right before the meeting.
Are you sure?
That's a whole packet.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Hello, I'm Richard Casino, owner of Rocky Top Tavern. This is a long time friend of the family, Stevie and Puda.
Happens to be a lawyer too, so I've known Rick for quite a while. I'm here to just to assist him. He indicated that he would like me to accompany him today, but Rick has prepared a statement just to make things go a little smoother and try to cover a lot of this in a cohesive manner. And then he's available to answer questions.
Richard, do you want us just to read it, or do you want to read it out loud to us? We don't need it read out loud.
No, you can just read
it. All right, great. Well, we're going to read it. There will be copy available to anybody who wants to read through the materials. Do you have the list of violations from last week?
They're in here.
Okay. Maybe recirculate it. Are we all ready?
Almost. Hey, just a moment.
All right. What I'm going to do first, unless you or Mr. Ancuda want to speak at this point, I'm going to ask if any member of the board has got any questions or comments or anything else that they want to say or present? Ken.
So I think part of the question, thank you for writing this, and a lot of these are really good ideas, and I think would be good role modeling for other places in town. There's a couple different pieces. One thing that came up last week wasn't just the violations, but the lack of response to the violations.
Yeah.
And that's not on the part of your patrons, that's on the part of
yes,
the owners of the establishment.
We will be responding promptly to all notices from the police department from here on out. There will be no missed, nothing will be missed. There was a couple that I did miss, but since we had the meeting, I have responded to all the notices.
Okay. And then the other piece, this is my field, alcohol and the drug education is my field, and I would just put a word of caution. Have you installed the breathalyzer machine yet?
Not yet.
The theory is very sound, but I would put forth a little bit of caution because so many establishments have seen the installation of breathalyzer machines as a challenge to their patrons, where it becomes a little bit of a competition and not so much as a safety measure for
them. Where I was going to tackle that problem is by anyone that is caught blowing excessively high numbers will automatically have a no trespass order put on them.
That's an important piece, and I'm happy to hear you say that. That's all I have right now.
Excellent. Anybody else? Dora?
A couple of things. When did you start stamping hands?
Just recently. We will. That's.
Oh, it's okay. So it's not. This is part of your plan. Yes. Is to start stamping. Okay.
Yes.
Is it read kind of that you're already doing that? So
no. I did do it. I did do it this weekend, actually.
Okay. So I just have sort of a procedural question, and that is that there is a hearing. The state, right? I really prefer waiting to make a decision on this until after that happens. Make a motion. The problem is we have to make it to a specific date. And what would probably happen is that we'd have to have a special meeting before the end of the month in order to be able to keep the license up to date.
I think we've had a prior situation where there was at least one prior situation where there was a hearing pending, and I'm going to ask Barb please to speak to the procedure that's going to be followed at what she knows about that procedure at the hearing and what's going to happen thereafter.
Well, what's being discussed is that Rocky Top has there's a hearing scheduled, although I don't know if a date is set. There's no date set, and that's what happens with these is it has trouble getting a date with the Department of Liquor Commissioners with the state. It's chances are that his license will expire prior to that hearing. If he doesn't have a date now, he's not going to get told about it within probably a two-week period. The board does have the authority to always review a license depending on the outcome of that hearing. Or you could condition on a successful. I mean, it's hard. I'm not sure because that's not our process. It's a state process. It's a little bit harder for us to, you know, to condition things depending on that. But you could, we should be able to get the results of that hearing, and those can go back to the board, and the board can reconsider licenses at that time.
If Department of Liquor Control finds against the owner in the hearing, mm-hmm. What are the consequences or possible consequences, Barb?
Could be anything. He could have a fine. He could have a license suspended for a few days. He could have his license revoked according to a discussion with the local representative of the Department of Liquor Commissioners. It doesn't appear as though that he will have a license revoked. But that's, again, up to the hearing. We don't know.
Anybody else on the board want to speak to this right now before I go?
I do. If we were to approve this license renewal, I would want it to be subject to review within a certain period, say at least, at the most, 3 months out. I am very concerned about the fact that there have been so many titled 7 notices and 3 that were not responded to. And what I'm hearing is, we'll be good. But there isn't a record of really good responsiveness to the concerns of the community expressed by way of the Title VII notices.
Can I make one correction? I just want to make one correction very quickly. That February 28th, we did receive. We didn't receive it on 3/14 when this was written.
I see.
But it came in at that point. So we've received them all since August, which is prior to the board making mm-hmm. the decision mm-hmm. that they have to respond.
Mm-hmm. Understood. Thank you.
And I only say that because that was a question last time with a couple of them mm-hmm. when there weren't responses, and they tended to be before that. So
okay. So you're telling me that there have been responses to all
to all of these?
No, I'm saying that there were responses to the last four.
Okay. So November 15 of 11, December 11, February 20, and February 28 have had responses?
Yes.
Okay. It doesn't change my concern here that we have a promise, and I just want to see that the promise is kept. And I would want to review this again for that reason alone. I'm concerned when I drive by the establishment; it's just not an attractive place on Main Street in Brattleboro.
Can I say something?
Yes, sure.
As I stated in my thing, that there's a big problem in Brattleboro with lawyering right now, and a lot of people that actually stand outside of front of my bar are not actually allowed there. They have no trespass orders on them, or they're banned. And because it's public property, they tell me we don't have to go anywhere. So, like in my letter, I stated that I was hoping to get no lawyering from 9 to 2 o'clock in the morning, so I have the power to be able to tell these people to move along. And it would make a great difference as far as the perception outside of the bar.
Well, that's a point well taken, and perhaps we should be considering that.
We can't.
I mean, not tonight.
No.
Down the road.
Dora?
The state law is pretty clear. There's been a number of judicial decisions that don't allow you to really be able to regulate loitering.
I think it is possible that no trespass notices could be broad enough to prohibit people from being right in front of the bar if they've been put out of the bar, and then you can call the cops if they're there and they're not supposed to be. Possibly. But at this point, that is I think, a separate question. Does anybody who's in attendance want to speak to this application?
Gene?
I know. Yeah, we met last week. He has a plan developed that he has a couple things that he wants to do to make things right down there. A couple things we've talked about, he needs to make some business decisions. People that are in the bar, anyone that gets one of these Title VII violations or notices or causes that, they need to be trespassed from the place. There's a reason people are hanging out there and loitering in front of there. You need to make it uncomfortable. If your customers are going out there dealing with these people, ban them. The only way to really stop it, make it uncomfortable there. But again, the loitering, we can go down there, but we only have so many officers to make it uncomfortable. We'll patrol down there, but there's other bars in town we have to patrol by. So
I did state in my letter to the board that there will anyone that I receive a Title VII violation for will have a no trespass order put on them. For DWI or for fighting anything, they will have a no trespass order.
Anybody else want to speak to this application?
Yes, Mr. Bill. I want to get something clarified, because the last time this came up, I was told by a police officer that there is no loitering law in Brattleboro. And so that was just announced, that was just brought up, and that's why we went to the call the police and have them shoo them away. Is that what it is? Because they can loiter anywhere in Brattleboro. There's no law against it.
To answer the question, a property owner can give notice to somebody saying, don't trespass on my property, don't come on my property. And that's a no trespass notice, and that's what Mr. Chino has been speaking about, getting notices served on people so then it's a crime to come back.
Even though it's a public sidewalk.
Well, that sidewalk may be a different question.
That was brought up. Yeah. Well, that was brought up. Okay.
Yeah. There's no loitering laws in Vermont, is what Dora was saying. Anybody else want to speak to this application?
Me.
Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about, I don't know if you have staff meetings or chief staff meetings.
Yes, we do.
Can you speak a little bit more about kind of what the mood is of your staff? Like, how are you guys feeling right now about how much control you have over the bar, and in looking forward?
In looking forward, well, we've added more staff on to, I'm hiring more people to help, because
we are busy. We've gotten busier, so to try to, you know, to deal with these increased problems, we're trying to have more staff on to be well more aware of everything. Everyone's on the same page. Everyone wants a respectable, clean place to work in and not have fights and stuff like that. So everyone works there, you know, enjoys working there. They like to come to work. They like to work together. So there is no problems. Since the Mole's Eye closed, that's when we first opened the business, we had a certain clientele, and there was no problems. Then the Mole's Eye closed, and we got all the problems from the Mole's Eye. So I've been trying to no trespass. Anyone that starts a problem, it's taken me, these people try to test me to see what I was going to do, because the other owner of the other bar didn't care. He just, whatever, you did whatever you wanted to, you could come back the next day, and there was no problems. And I've had to teach these people that I'm not tolerant of it, and I won't accept it, and this is what's going to happen to you if you fight, and that I'm just not tolerant of it. So it's taken these people some time to realize that I mean business, and it's getting better. It's taken some time, but it's gotten a lot better since these problems first started for us. Because we didn't have this problem at all when we first started. And it's getting a lot better, and I think that over the course of the next year, we won't have really any problems at all.
Beth?
I'm sorry.
You're sorry.
The mic. So anyway, Beth Schrader, Barbara from Education. The issue is over-service at times. I mean, and I know that that's over-serving, meaning above the limit, legally drunk. So there are things that can be done to educate your staff better about over-service. Yep. So I would encourage you to include that in your plan.
In my plan is now, instead of every 2 years, I make the staff go every single year to the training seminar.
Yep, and we're the ones who co-sponsor that, so.
Yep, we're there.
So that, but I think there's other things that you can do with your staff to, like, help them to know, recognize when someone's overserved. I've recommended that. There's also a brand new publication about for on-premise licenses, and I'd be happy to email it to you if you give me an email, that really clearly outlines how to prevent that from happening and gives you guidelines on policies that you can add to avoid overservice. So I would suggest that it might go well if you were to look at that document and be proactive and make some other changes around that, and I'd be happy to send that to you.
Sure, I'd be glad to hear that.
Yeah, I want to be clear. I specifically asked about your staff because this is an extraordinarily comprehensive document, but it's also one that there's no way you can pull off by yourself. And I'm not looking to decrease your responsibility in this because I
wrote that myself.
No, I know. I'm saying.
Well, let's let him finish.
I think this is great, and there's a lot of measures in here, and I just wanted to make sure your staff is on board with this, because there's no way. I find it difficult to believe that you could pull all this off by yourself without your staff supporting you and having the same vision that you're telling us you have of this safe environment where there aren't fights. So I just want to make sure that you have backup on this, because it's a pretty strong vision. We just want to make sure it happens.
No, everyone that works for me has the same goals in mind as I do. That's for sure.
So I agree with Ken that this statement for the liquor license renewal and the alcohol sale policy and the attachments that you gave to us are a really good plan. And I understand that there have been problems in the past, and I hope that you can pull it off and make it work better. It's important, really important, at the very least, that you respond to notices of violation right away.
I will.
And so there are two or three conditions that I think are going to be incorporated into the motion here. I would say, Chris, my preference would be 6 months rather than 3 months, if that's okay with you. But if you want 3 months, then, you know, I'll probably vote in favor. But
I can be persuaded. I'll tell you my concern. There will be Gallery Walk in June. It's the biggest one. And people are on the street for a long time. This is a huge draw to Brattleboro. part of our job, I think, here is to exert some leadership to make the town an attractive place for people to visit and make decisions on locating businesses and locating their residents and their families. If we have an establishment on Main Street that has scary behavior going on around it, I'm going to feel that that it's not appropriate to have a liquor license at that establishment. And that's why I'm thinking that after 3 months, if something goes wrong on any of these gallery walk nights, or speaking personally, if I'm on the street coming back from some event with my wife and we don't feel comfortable walking by the Rocky Top, I'm going to say something about it here. This is our town. It's a quality of life issue. It is really important. So I'm not convinced that we should do longer than 3 months, but I'm willing to listen to an argument about 6 months.
Right. You make a good point. Right. Dora, was there something else you wanted to say?
A couple of things. I agree with Chris about the 3 months, because I'm looking at what we've just identified as a pretty comprehensive plan, and it's a good plan, but we don't really have any way of knowing that it's being used, that it's working. So I think to reevaluate it in 3 months makes sense. The one thing I want to say, and this goes back to the staff training and what Beth was talking about, overservice, because that to me is the thing that I'm most concerned about, is the issue of overservice. And I noticed that a number of the number of the reports that we've had is that staff say that they suspect that the individual was using something else, they went in the bathroom or they went somewhere else and they were using something else, and I have concern, this goes back to the staff training, about sort of putting it off on saying that they must be using another substance that we didn't give them and we don't have any responsibility, because that goes back to the staff training and being aware of what's going on with a person and serving them. And I do have concerns about that, the need to take responsibility for over-serving by you and your staff in those situations.
I think we're ready for a motion. I wrote up this additional language if you just want to look at it, either of you, or I'll do it.
You're giving it.
All right, here.
Procedurally, chair doesn't seem to make motions
around. Well, you can make a motion.
All right, here, I'll do it. All right. I move to approve the first class liquor license renewal for Ticino Enterprises LTD, doing business as Rocky Top Tavern, located 95 Main Street, with the condition that the owner report any State Department of Liquor Control violations within 24 hours of notice, and that failure to respond to a Brattleboro notice of alcohol-related incidents within 14 days would result in the Liquor License Commission's reconsideration of the liquor license, with the renewal further to be subject to review after 3 months by the Brattleboro Select Board and after any violation as determined by the Department of Liquor Control.
Do we have in there about the meetings, the quarterly meetings?
No.
So we should probably have that in there.
All right, and further subject to the owner attending quarterly bar owners meetings in Brattleboro. Is there any further discussion?
Could I inquire as to what way you stated that it's subject to after 3 months review? Does that mean that Rick would be notified if you want to have him come in for a review, or is it going to be an agenda item after 3 months? Just to clarify that, is it? It may be that you want to say we'll put it on our schedule if we want to.
From what I heard, we've expressed now that we want it on the agenda in 3 months.
Yes, affirmative.
Right, Dora.
There's only one thing that we haven't dealt with, and that is the issue of the state hearing.
We did, and any violation determined by DLC.
All right.
Any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed? That motion carries 4-0. Good luck to you putting this plan in motion. Thanks for coming, Steve.
Can we just make sure that when we have this on the agenda next, that we see if Bill Nance can come.
The next item on the agenda, I'm sorry, I guess we'll take a motion to adjourn as liquor commissioners.
I move to adjourn as liquor commissioners.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed? That motion carries 4-0. Now we'll take a motion, please, to convene as water and sewer commissioners.
I move to convene as water and sewer commissioners.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed? That motion carries 4-0. First item on the agenda as water and sewer commissioners is Commonwealth Dairy, and we're glad to see Mr. Eth here.
As you can see by the letter in your packet, apparently the yoga business is doing pretty well because they're requesting an increase in water and sewer allocation. We have the ability to supply the water, and we can treat the wastes, but this is all contingent on state approval. They have to review the permit and modify it and agree to it. And we also have to include Algiers, Guilford, Indoor, because it's part of their system, so they have to agree to it. And further, we have quite a few stipulations in there that they have to meet certain town, rural, existing ordinances, and in the next year, this will only be good for a year, they have to come up with a pre-treatment program to get those BODs and TSF numbers down. So there's a lot hanging on it, but we can do it, assuming the state goes along with it.
Maybe we could address a little bit the financial ramifications of the agreement in terms of revenue we're going to generate and the timing when we're going to receive that for the increase in volume. Barbara, Ricky, the way.
Well, just the connection fees would be close to $4 million. And then the water use, I haven't calculated what that would come out to, but it would be significant. And sewer also. Plus, there's built in, if they do go over on some of the BOD or some of that, to be fines, so it could be significant depending upon how it works out.
We're confident that the costs associated with this will cover any additional costs that would be required for treatment of a stronger waste. And there has been a request that the payments for the allocations be split, that the first be in our fiscal year 12, the second one be in January of our fiscal year 13. And that has been done before in other agreements. So that's what our staff's request to the board is.
Barb, could you explain briefly the work that we're going to be doing over the course of the next year to develop a schedule for extra charges for waste that's more highly concentrated than household waste?
Right. Currently, our ordinances don't address high strength waste. With the improvements at our wastewater treatment plant, we are able to accept higher strength waste. The other thing is we're also going to be able to accept the septage as well. It had been in the past when we received septage, we didn't have the abilities to really as automatically check the kind of what type of waste it was, and now we do with our new plant, we will. And so what we're going to be doing over the course of the next 8 months or so is reviewing and revamping our ordinances and actually developing a fee structure for higher or stronger wastes. This is a common thing to do for wastewater treatment plants. Won't impact a lot of people, impact very few businesses. And basically the whole idea is that when you have a stronger waste, that the cost associated with treating that extra strength isn't borne by all the households, but it's actually borne by the entity that's producing the stronger waste.
What's the estimated time of completion for that the schedule?
We would hope to have that all in place probably by October of this year, so that then it would be as an ordinance change, so that it would be in place. We will, depending on the not having a good sense of what it's going to look like at the end, we may want to look at doing an ordinance change with a specific start date that coincides mm-hmm. with quarterly payments or and with adequate notice.
Excellent. Does anybody else on the board have any comments on this agenda item with respect to the Commonwealth Dairy App contract, I guess it is?
Mm-hmm. I'd say, if I might, if this is the kind of problem we have to address, we're in great shape.
Yeah.
I am so pleased to see this business doing this well, and I think that it's in everyone's best interest to accommodate them on this. It doesn't impact us negatively. It doesn't impact the town negatively at all. It's an orderly approach to solving an issue, and it just seems to satisfy everyone's concerns.
Would you like to make a motion?
I'll make a motion.
Excellent.
I move that we authorize the town manager to enter into an agreement with Commonwealth Dairy that calls for a $5,000 per day fine if the water/sewer superintendent finds that the plant has violated its state permit and enables the company to make two payments for the increased allocation, the first in fiscal year 2012 and the second in January of fiscal year 2013.
Is there anybody who's in attendance who wants to speak to that motion? Anybody else on the board have any other comments?
Bill left.
What's that?
Bill left.
Yeah, Bill left. Well, hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed? That motion carries 4-0. Mr. Ethier, are you also here to speak to the change orders at the treatment plant?
Yep, we have seven change orders here that we ran past the oversight, and they had a special meeting of them a week ago, and they have approved them, agreed to them. One of them is to eliminate some coatings at the chlorine contact tank. That's a sizable credit, $24,000 change. RBC air piping modifications, another sizable credit, $24,000 change. The other ones are adders, a platform around the emergency generator so we get up to it to service it and take the daily readings and stuff, is a $16,000 adder. Additional conduits to the chlorine contact and selector building that they thought there was capacity in the existing ones, but there wasn't enough, so they had to add. Plant network system, the original computer system down there, they were going to have cover everything. And now they've decided to break it into three systems to make it more reliable. And we all agree that that's a good idea. And the other is a painting situation where they couldn't match the proper block. So we have to paint what they're going to put in.
I move to approve the proposed change to the wastewater treatment plant in the amount of $7,302, which represents a credit.
Is there any further discussion? Dora?
Well, I just have a question for Rick. You mentioned one of the things that they thought there was enough capacity, but they found out not. Like, how did they not know that there wasn't enough capacity? Was it a situation where they had to open it up, or?
Yeah, once you got it opened up, we found out that all the conduits had more wires in them than they assumed they had.
Okay.
So, plus, to keep running, we had to have two sets of wires running on the old while we put in the new.
Mm-hmm.
In the end, we'll have some more future use.
Cool.
Any other comments from the board or anybody who's in attendance? Hearing none, all those in favor of Ken's motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed? That motion carries 4-0. We're looking for a motion, please, to adjourn as Water and Sewer Commissioners.
I move to adjourn as Water and Sewer Commissioners.
All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Aye. Anybody opposed? That motion carries 4-0. The next item on the agenda is unfinished business, and the only item under unfinished business is the grants manual. Barb? The rumor I hear is that most of us aren't ready for a final vote on the grants manual tonight. but maybe you could briefly outline for us the primary changes.
Actually, Suzanne Bansley is here this evening. Suzanne is our grants manager. And I know, Suzanne, if you want to come up and introduce yourself, and if you want to talk about some of the changes briefly, that would be great.
Suzanne Bansley, grants manager for town. Major changes in the manual are many grammar errors, typos were corrected throughout the book. Contact information was changed to made more general, so it doesn't have to be updated annually. Grant coordinator position was eliminated, and all situations where that was mentioned was replaced with grant manager. The job responsibilities were edited to reflect actual functions. No responsibilities were removed. They were just placed under different titles. Department sponsor section was added to the grant cycle policies and procedure. That's found on page 23. Appeal section was added to the grant cycle policies and procedures. That's found on page 25. The deferred loans periodic review section, which was approved in a previous meeting as an addendum, is now included in this manual as part of it. Grants administration, anywhere that that phrase has occurred, was replaced with implementation, which is the phrase that we use for that section of the grants process. A closeout section was left voided in the previous manual, and only a title for the section was there, so I filled it in. And we approved a new GIST previously, so the example is in this manual, along with the explanations for each item of the GIST line by line.
What does that mean, GIST?
Grant information status tracking document. It follows the grant as it goes through. Previous GIST had every phase in the form. This one is separating the forms by phase so that we're not wasting paper as we go through. So now the one that you get in the beginning is just the application phase. When we get to the award phase, it gets added later, et cetera. A checklist was added to replace the implementation section of the GIST. And I had already mentioned that directions for each item in the GIST were included in the manual as well. And the revolving loan fund policies were included in the appendix of this manual. And that pretty much summarizes the major changes.
Thank you. That's a great summary. Yeah. Thanks.
Available to answer any questions if you
good
have
job,
them.
Susan.
Anybody have any questions right now?
I would very much recommend that the Grants 101 section be moved even higher, because having just read that, I learned a lot. And coding, I think that's probably where people might turn first, because it's a really nice, concise way of explaining things, and maybe even, I'm not trying to add work, but maybe even on in that section, adding the correlating page numbers to where those things are going to be found, because it seems like that really is the basis by which the rest of the manual jumps out. I mean, the page numbers is what it is. I would just move that Grants 101 even up to the top, because it's really quite well done. It's also a little, it's slightly amusing for a grants manual. It's actually slightly amusing, period. It's funny.
I'll encourage you to read the whole thing. I'll move it to the top.
Yeah.
All right. Any other comments for right now? All right, well, hopefully this item will be on the agenda in 2 weeks, and we'll all be ready to vote on it at that time.
Looking forward to it.
I don't think any action is requested on this item. I'm glad you found it amusing.
I did. You'll read it and you'll see one.
Yeah, all right. And now we're going to go to new business. The first item under new business is to award the bid for cemetery maintenance, recreation, and parks. Hi, Carol.
So I'm here this evening to review with you the annual bids for cemetery maintenance, the maintenance, seasonal maintenance of Prospect Hill Cemetery and Morningside Cemetery. This year we received three bids ranging from $17,800 to $25,080. We received them from Turner and Renault, Black Mountain Landscape, and Vermont Hillside Lawn Service. The low bid this year was Turner and Renault, and I'd like to recommend to you this evening that the bid be awarded to Turner and Renault for $17,800.
Can we get a motion?
Move to award a $17,800 contract to Turner and Renault for performance of seasonal maintenance at Prospect Hill Cemetery and Morningside Cemetery.
Is there any discussion or any questions for Ms. Lalotte?
Are we allowed to ask who holds the bid now? Like, who did it last year?
That was Bill Keith Landscape.
kind of goes back and forth.
It does kind of back and forth.
Kind of like the plowing in the parking lot.
I noticed there's at least one new name on here that I haven't seen before.
Yeah, I believe they're from the Dover area. Actually, Westminster. I'm sorry, Westminster.
Is there any further discussion about the motion? Hearing none. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed? The motion carries 4-0. Next item on the agenda is consideration and approval of the FY13 parking budget. So I guess that since I'm seeing this in the binder kind of for the first time, my expectation is that there's a committee that worked on this, and maybe Barb could explain the process.
The Transportation Committee is the committee that works on the budget for parking. They met numerous times, actually, on the budget. One of the things that they kind of prevented them from, the budget was actually pretty simple, but they spent a lot of time talking about the marketing of the parking, working with BABB and the chamber on finding ways to market the smart cards, and also work at developing brochures for particularly tourists who come in, that maps that identify long-term parking, short-term parking, those types of things. There's also been a lot of other work that staff has been working on with regard to, we're going to be seeing some, putting up some pay boxes, and about 5 different pay boxes around town, so that people can more easily pay their parking tickets. The chamber is willing, and we have a new machine that will enable smart cards to be purchased at and also recharged at the chamber, and making them again a little more accessible. There are a few other things I can't remember. Looking at Patrick.
We're adding meters on Linden Street. Right. We're adding meters on Park Place. Mm-hmm. We'll be installing the drop boxes. John did a great job working with parking to allow folks to pay their parking citations on the town website. We've improved the information that is delivered from the town website. We're working with our partners to provide a publicity campaign to educate the public on our parking system and how to utilize it.
I believe we have a rollout date for a lot of this information in May. That's our target day. Target time is to kind of roll out all the new information. We'll have up the drop boxes. We'll have the smart cards done. We're looking at some other publicity things to do. And I believe we're starting in May. So this budget, and part of the reason the budget was deferred because, and they actually started looking at, they actually added a new line item for marketing, and I think they put about $1,500 in the FY13 budget to do some continual marketing of the parking system, with the idea making it a friendlier and more easily understood system.
I seem to recall there was some discussion last year about marketing of smart cards, maybe handing out some free smart cards and then making people filling them up on their own afterwards.
Right. That's one of the things that they're still looking at, yes.
What's
that's
that?
A possibility that will be occurring as well.
So. Any other comments? I'm sorry to speak first, but any other comments?
Yeah,
Chris.
I'm grateful that the town went ahead in such a systematic way in response to the concern it brought up. I said earlier that it's an enterprise fund, let's be entrepreneurial, and they've done it and gone right through a wonderful sequence of events, with lots of input and deliberation, and my compliments all around to the town administration and to the committee. And thank you very much. I think it'll be in the town's best interest.
Anybody else want to speak to this? Sure.
But I just have a question. Does this have any parking increases
no.
in it? Okay.
Nope. No changes to
just
anything.
Double checking.
Tickets or times or anything. Those would be ordinance changes.
Maybe I could ask John briefly. I know that there was damage to the parking structure as a result of Irene and also at least some short-term suspension of our ability to use, what is it, Preston Lot, is it called, right mm-hmm. across from the co-op? What impact, if any, is there going to be on the prior year's parking fund enterprise budget as a result of Tropical Storm Irene?
As far as the damage goes, that was all insurable, and we suffered about $80,000 in damage, and we did recover those costs from our insurer. In terms of lost revenues, I really haven't looked real closely at that, David. It doesn't look like it's real far off at this point. I'm not seeing a huge drop in the revenue stream, so I think we should be okay. But I will look at that for the next meeting when I present the budget information and have a good answer for you then.
Thank you, because Harmony Lot's also been partially unused for a period of the time as well because of the Brooks House fire.
Yep.
Yeah. Any other questions at this time? I guess we need a motion to approve the FY13 parking fund budget in the amount of $834,095 in total revenues and expenditures.
So moved.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of that motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed? Their motion carries 4-0. The next item on the agenda is change orders at the Union Station project. Barb.
As David, as you indicated at the beginning of the meeting, the project down by the waterfront, the Union Station project is moving along. The buildings that are coming down are down. They're doing most of the work moving of land at this point. And we knew that the work in that area, it was a brownfield, it has a lot of contamination. There's a lot of restrictions on what can and can't be done. In fact, there's a lot of eyeballs on the work that's occurring. So from our environmental professionals that we've hired to assist us with the corrective action plan on that site. Thus far, we've had a couple of things that have come up that were not anticipated, and the first, and they resulted in two change orders. The first is a change order in the amount of $4,900. We knew that there was a hydraulic lift under Bob's service station, but there was actually a second one that was found, a piston that was under there. We did not anticipate that. That required both the removal of the piston as well as additional testing around the soil area. To the tune of $4,900. The second change order is in the amount of $8,820. That's costs associated with discovery that under the gasworks, under part of the gasworks building, there was a crawl space that we had previously not known about. Due to the contamination in that particular area, our environmental consultant, in coordination with the Department of Environmental Conservation of the state, who's also monitoring very closely this project, came up with a plan of how to fill that crawl space. It was determined to be too risky to actually break down the concrete slab, because of the possibility of disturbing earth underneath of it. And so what was done, there were big holes were drilled into the concrete slab, and gravel and a flowable fill. Gravel was put down and pushed against the side, and then a flowable fill was placed on the top. A flowable fill is a mixture of, it's kind of like a soft concrete, so that if you have to go back and take it up. It's a little easier to take up. And so that costs $8,820. Both these changes were discussed at Union Station, and they were, you know, unforeseen, and we are asking that they be approved at this time. The work, because of, you know, finding of the hydraulic lift or the piston, you know, there's not, we went ahead and did that work again, and we also did the concrete slabs. We are actually asking you to, it says to approve, we're actually asking you to ratify those. The delay of that, there was no kind of getting around doing it, and the delay of that would have kind of set the schedule off a little further. We do anticipate a future change order with regard to, there may be an additional charge associated with that lift, depending on if what's testing is found, et cetera. And we are in right now what we would consider the higher risk portion, because we're working in all the brownfield things right now. And so we actually, after a meeting today with the engineer on site and the environmental consultant, we feel as though we're getting close to rounding a bend as far as some of the really higher risk costs, things that can go wrong. So in that, it would be good. After this, then some of the unknowns are if we have a ledge issue, where they have to do some of the tunneling, et cetera, for underground work. There may be, you know, we know there's some ledge there, we just don't know how much. We've done that as a unit cost. If there's more than we anticipated, that could be an issue, but it probably wouldn't be an issue. Oh, and the second one would be there's concrete under the pavement, and we'll be taking up the concrete and the pavement to put in the new paving and the new drive. There could be, we don't know how much concrete there is under the paving, but we don't anticipate, if either of those go badly, we don't anticipate it being more than $10,000. We have about right at $60,000 is our contingency on this project, and with that we have $13,120 that we would have spent.
Is it fair to say that the total cost of the project on the $60,000 contingency is about $880,000? Is that what I remember?
About $820,000. So we have between 7% and 8% contingency going into construction, which is a little higher maybe than you might have, except for the fact that it's a brownfield.
Maybe we can get a motion, and then we'll see if there's any questions. Dora?
Move to approve two Union Station project change orders in the total amount of 13, and actually we're ratifying right now, approving. Move to ratify two Union Station project change orders in the total amount of $13,120.
Is there any further comments or questions, Dora?
So, since we know that there's some things coming up, it might be a good idea to have to start having regular meetings.
Actually, we talked about that. We're going to have the committee's going to, committee members are invited to our site meetings, which are on Friday at 1. And on those, on Fridays, we're going to, on a weekly basis, make a decision whether there should be a meeting for the full committee on the following Tuesday.
Okay.
And the reason we're doing that, so like this week, we anticipate we will have received a pay requisition from the contractor. So I would anticipate that we'll have a meeting next week because of that, so that we can, so that the committee can look at any of the, look and see how we're progressing on the budget, and also keeping them up to date on any changes that may occur.
I mean, not that I would assume, I mean, these, obviously you had to do these, I mean, it's, there's no way around it, it's
right.
Just that,
no, but
it's nice to utilize the committee structure.
Prior oversight is better if possible.
Right. Well, and the other, we are looking at, you know, if there is some contingency, some of the contingencies left, we have a couple of priority alternatives that we are hoping to do. One is a conduit to be placed by the paving, by the mm-hmm. paving by the sidewalk, mm-hmm. in the event that we are in the future able to secure funds to take the electric lines that run along the river and put them under. We don't have enough money to do that because the total cost of that for CVPS and Fairpoint and the conduit would be closer to our full contingency. but it makes sense to, if at all possible, to put the conduit in so that you're not tearing up things later. We are also looking at a possible watering hydrant in the area.
Watering hydrant?
Yeah, a hydrant that would be used not for fire, not a fire hydrant, but a hydrant for water usage. Mm-hmm. So those are some of the change orders that are not change orders. Those are some of the alternates that if we have, if we do well with keeping the budget down, that we're hoping we'll be able to plan.
Any further discussion? We have a motion to approve to ratify the change orders. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed? That motion carries 4-0. The next item on the agenda is a proposed ordinance amendment. First reading of Chapter 13, Article 8, Camping. Is there somebody who wants to speak to this item? Carol, are you here for this?
Here for listening purposes, and if you have any questions.
Yeah.
Okay.
What we're doing here is we don't have camping facilities in our public parks. We're not really made up for overnight stays, and so what this does is puts into place essentially a no camping ordinance. No person shall. To camp shall include the placing of any bedding, sleeping bag, or other materials at a site to serve as a sleeping area, the placing of any tent, lean-to, other structure or vehicle at a site to serve as a sleeping or living area, or the use of any public park for sleeping between the hours of 9 p.m. and 8 a.m. No person...
Can mm-hmm. I read the next one with
sure.
a proposed change?
Sure.
Because I found the next one to be very confusing. Mm-hmm. I would just say no person shall camp in any public park in the town of Brattleboro unless camping in that park is authorized by the Department of Recreation and Parks.
Okay.
That whole middle good. Part of the sentence just confused me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a
so no person shall camp in any public park in the town of Brattleboro unless camping in that park is authorized by the Department of Recreation and Parks.
That's easy.
Yep.
All
over that.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry to interrupt.
No, that's good. Ordinance shall be designated a criminal ordinance pursuant to 24 VSA 1971B. Shall be the duty of any police officer of the town to order any person camping in a public park in the town of Brattleboro to vacate and enforce these provisions against any person be found in violation. Maximum fine of $500 shall be imposed for a violation. In addition to the enforcement procedure available before district court, the town of Brattleboro is authorized to commence a civil action to obtain injunction and other appropriate relief or to pursue any other remedy authorized by law.
The language should be in addition to the enforcement procedures available for the Superior Court.
Oh, yeah.
Superior Court.
District Court doesn't exist anymore. And Superior Court is then any one of the units, criminal, civil, or family, which doesn't apply.
Okay.
Can you explain very briefly just what it means, first reading, second reading, and then adoption, so that we're clear on the record?
This is their town ordinance changes have several parts. The first is a first reading, and that's what we're doing today, is just reading it so that people know what's being proposed. The next time the board meets on the 17th, we will have a second reading in which we will again read the ordinance, and at that point the chair will open a public hearing at which anyone can discuss what is being proposed. The board then will have a discussion following the public hearing and has the ability to vote up or down the change, the proposed amendment. Following that, the ordinance is placed in a public notice in the Reformer, the Saturday following the Tuesday meeting at which it was approved. It is then, citizens then have 20 days from that publication by which to notify, to gather signatures, to argue against the proposed changes. And if there is no, if there nothing happens with that, as far as there is no actions, opposition or action taken, at it's 20 days following the Saturday publication that an ordinance actually takes effect.
Are there any comments or questions about this proposed ordinance? Howard.
I just wonder, did this come out of committee work, or where was this? Just come out of your office? Just wonder the history of the proposed.
It came.
I'd like to say that it's codifying what was the policy of the Parks and Recreation Department.
Right.
So it's always been in their policies. It hasn't been all.
It was during the discussions, obviously, when we had campers and people were saying, do we have an ordinance against it? And we're like, no, we have regulations against it. We have rules against it. And I think that then there was some interest at that time to say, well, let's do more than just have a department regulation. And so now it's an ordinance, proposed ordinance change.
Any further comments or questions? Thank you for doing that work and getting that together. The next item on the agenda, that first reading having been completed, is an ordinance amendment banning parking on Frost Street. Barb.
And what this does is it bans parking on the southerly side of Frost Street from its intersection with Elliott Street to Elm Street. It also bans on the northerly side of Frost Street from the intersection with Elm Street to in a westerly direction for 500 feet. This grew out of concerns that parking, where parking was allowed on Frost Street, it was very difficult for people, drivers to drive as well as pedestrians to walk, and it was determined at traffic safety. This one started with traffic safety, and it was agreed that we should extend the no parking area, particularly with the large vehicles that come in and out of the Kilman Drive.
Are there any further comments in connection with the second reading of the amendment to the parking ordinance?
You are asked to open up a public hearing.
If there's nothing relating to the second reading, I'll now open the public hearing relating to amendment of the Code and Order of Ordinances to ban parking on certain areas of Frost Street. Is there any comment from the board or anybody who's in attendance at the meeting about this proposed amendment to the Code of Ordinances? Hearing none, I'll close. Oh, Dora.
Well,
hi, Dora.
Well, I just, because we did get a, we did get a letter from David Cadron on asking a few questions as to why, I mean, Barb did answer some of that, but he was expressing concern about the elimination of those parking space spots and says that, you know, he and his neighbors use it often, so I just thought we should get that on the record.
Is there any other discussion on the proposed ordinance amendment to ban parking in certain areas of Frost Street? Hearing none, then I'll close the public hearing. We're ready for a motion.
I move to approve the town ordinance amendment restricting parking on Frost Street as proposed.
Is there any further discussion? Dora.
Well, I just have a question related to this. How much reach out has been done? Because we keep doing these ordinances where we're, you know, restricting parking on streets where there's businesses and residents, and I just was wondering how much reach out has been done to those folks that have addresses on that street to inform them about this, other than the standard public notices.
Standard public notice, but the majority of the change on this one is just really with the Brattleboro Kiln Dry.
In fact, the change originated from, I think it's a business
from
owner
a business
who's on Frost Street across the street from the Kiln Dry.
Right.
Who felt that it wasn't safe to have parking there when the trucks were coming and going. And we did, I think, get public input with respect to the changes up on Linden Street from the state and from the people at Linden Lodge and the it's not Linden Lodge anymore, but up the retreat, and the changing of the parking ordinance over by the Little League field was done based upon requests from neighboring landowners. Those are the three I remember this last year. Any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anybody opposed? That motion carries 4-0. The next matter on the agenda is a summary of the current progress of our planning to improve pedestrian vehicular safety. Barb, please.
I updated the board 2 weeks ago on what we've been doing, and last Thursday on the 29th, there was a meeting with representatives from local bike safe routes to schools, Safe Kids, AARP, Department of Public Health, Wyndham Regional Commission, Healthy Communities, Rescue Inc., the police, fire, public works, planning, and myself. It was a very good meeting, and where the organizations went around and first explained what their current education reach out is and where their priorities are. We then also discussed kind of three goals for our next meeting, what we're going to be, and actually this we've already started on quite a bit of this. The first will be a development of a special education campaign for April. One of the things we're looking at doing is getting not only into the schools, but also utilizing AARP, and they have a direct mail list that they can utilize that they've been, as well as, Carol Lott was there with the senior center as well, she left, to get information out to all areas of the age spectrum. We're working on development of a townwide pedestrian safety assessment, and that assessment actually is one that has been used. There are several tools out there that can be used. We're looking now at one that's been proposed by Healthy Communities in coordination with AARP. What we'll be doing then is getting the word out and trying to develop groups of citizens that will go together with the checklists, and we'll do assessments of various routes. We will then bring that information then comes in, and we will then be able to take that information. I'm assuming that we will be kind of using our geographical information system to do more of that plotting on a map, so we can actually identify areas, and then going back to the select board really for prioritization and implementation of some of the solutions. And one of the things also is working with Alice Charkies to help expand. They have a great Safe Routes to School program at Green Street, in which we're working with Safe Routes, Public Works working with Safe Routes. They've been able to implement, receive several grants, and also implement a lot of different infrastructure improvements, making, I think, the travel to Green Street School, and we're looking really to get that at Academy School. We've not been successful at expanding that program there, but we're looking to do that. At the last week's traffic safety, we had several people from Academy, parents and crossing guards. The principal was here. Chief Picasso and Public Works Director Steve Barrett went there, and I think if anyone's driven on Western Avenue, we've put up the removable bollards up there to help define the crosswalk, that's utilized by the school, in attempts to anytime you can narrow down the width of the lane, you tend to reduce the speed of the traffic. We've also have done heightened patrols. Police have been there in the mornings and in the afternoons during the pickup and drop-off of the kids. One of the things we found at Green Street that the Safe Routes to School found, and the Public Works working with them, is in the crossing guards that I think we would find at Academy, is the parents, it's people trying to get to school and drop off their kids in a hurry. Create some of the bigger hazards. So it's reminding people, and that's worse there because of the turn that goes into Academy School and those types of things. So there's a lot of passing on the right that happens during pickup and drop-off, and so we've got police officers who are directed patrol there. In addition, the Public Works engineering technician has created a completed all of our 180 crosswalks. He's overlaid that with a map of our existing streetlights, which are actually owned by CVPS. The streetlights give you location as well as lumen information. It allows us to identify cross. In doing all the mapping of this, we've also identified crosswalks that are not accessible, don't have street lights, are without the appropriate signage. By the end of the week, all the signage will be corrected, and we will be having together an estimate cost for making all the sidewalks accessible. With regard to the street lights, he has done some cross-referencing of the street lights with that, and so that we can then go back to CVPS. And what we're trying to get to is get this lighting standards so that we have kind of a set standard of lighting for, you know, streetlights that are on Western Avenue versus maybe, you know, streetlights at crosswalks on Western Avenue, streetlights on crosswalks off of maybe Oak, maybe a different lumen. And also look for standards for LED lighting as we move more towards the LED lighting. I will anticipate we have a meeting, a second meeting this month with the committee, and I will assume at that meeting will be, by the time that meeting is done, we will have a full plan with dates for the assessments and the start of the campaign, as well as and we, by that time, we're to have a meeting, also try to get a meeting for the safe routes as well. So with our time frame, we're looking to accomplish quite a few things within the next 3 weeks.
Thank you.
Dora?
Well, a couple of things. One is, one of the issues that happens at Academy School, and I know that I stood out there when I was campaigning, right at that turn, and so I watched what happens there with people sort of, you know, rushing to turn in and passing people on the right. But one of the things that also happens with that stretch of Route 9, and there's other places where it happens too, and that is the angle of the sun. And you know, while you're sort of going forward, looking at things, trying to deal with how to create more visibility when people are kind of blinded in their car, it, you know, would be helpful if there's things that can be done to the intersection to, you know, I mean, it's one of those things that may, or even moving the crosswalk to a place where it's not such a huge problem, I might need, but I do think that at certain times of the year, in the winter is one of those times of year when it really is right at the times when they're doing pickup and drop off, and that sun on the whichever side it is that those cars coming in that direction can't see anything. So, I just want to comment because thank you, you know, for the plan. I know that there's a lot of people out there that are thinking that we need to do bigger things, and I don't think there's anyone at this table that doesn't think that there are certain places in this community that need a complete redesign, but we don't, you know, we're trying to get sort of the best bang for the least amount of bucks at the moment, because any of those things take time and money. So, you know, it's not that people are ignoring the concerns and calls from people that they, you know, that they want more. You know, right now this is what we have, and integrated into our town plan will be issues of improving pedestrian safety and improving different sections of town and crosswalks and making it more friendly. So I just want to put that out there for, you know, because I know that there's people that are like, they want action and they want more than what's been mentioned. And so, you know, it's not falling on deaf ears. We do hear you. And keep coming and bringing up your issues and coming to meetings.
Anybody on this side of the table want to speak? All right. You want?
Well, all I have is just an anecdote, and it has to do with lighting on Western Avenue at night. On Friday night, I was coming back from an event in Marlboro, and so I paid attention because of the, you know, all the events that have happened with all the injuries. And I was wondering, why is it that I don't really see very well on this stretch of the road? And it was mainly between Academy School and the covered bridge. And I noticed that the street lights were very bright, but I still couldn't see very well. Why should that be? And I think I was blinded by the street light. I mean,
it's a little too bright.
So, well, or not shaded properly at the source. So I thought I'd just mention that. It's an opportunity. Just bring it up. It's just one item. It's ironic that lighting can blind you to, contrary to, you know, to the objective, which is safety.
I think one of the factors that, or one of the items that is going to be reviewed is the type of light mm-hmm. that's coming from the various lights mm-hmm. and the impact that switching to LED lights may have mm-hmm. because the LED lights are shielded and downcast and it limits the focus of the light. Mm-hmm. It will impact the coverage mm-hmm. as those lights are replaced, okay. as the current lights are replaced with LED lights. And so we're going to need to take that into account to make sure that if we're saving money by having the LED lights, which are actually brighter, mm-hmm. But they cast less of a scope of light, mm-hmm. and we'll have to deal with that. And that's one of the issues that needs to be addressed. Let me say a couple of things. First off, I would note that I continue to feel very strongly about the importance of the educational mm-hmm. component of what's being developed and considered. I saw a guy with his dog trying to cross the crosswalk right in front of the post office this morning, and vehicles kept passing by without stopping, and he kept trying to step out into traffic in what is probably the most clearly known crosswalk right in the center of town, and nobody stopped for him. And I think that enforcement needs to be stepped up mm-hmm. at crosswalks. I read in the paper that the police have redirected yes. some of the grant money to enforcement. I've read some people saying try to enforce the laws with respect to jaywalking, but it's way important that we enforce the laws requiring drivers to stop at crosswalks, because there's too much failure to do so in town. I also would respond very briefly to follow up on what Dora said about people who want to see big money projects. I really commend the administration for the steps that have been taken to try to identify the best way to improve pedestrian and traffic safety in this town. This has been a comprehensive approach that's looked at all different sorts of issues that we're confronting, from crosswalks to narrowing streets to education and the like. And I am not convinced at this point that throwing money at redesign of intersections is the core of what's going to improve pedestrian safety. What was talked about most at town meeting was changing the culture within the town through education, so that people who are walking and people who are driving are respecting one another. And there's many other steps that we can take, individual steps that will increase pedestrian safety. And I think we're developing a comprehensive, sensible plan. And I don't really see that there's any basis for impatience right now. We're really tending to it in a quite diligent manner right now, I think. And I commend administration for that. Dora.
Well, just to respond to that, I think what people are looking for is some of the things that have come out of projects like the AARP project in Dan Burden and some of the healthy cities, which is narrowing of roads, why adding more sidewalks, why, you know, adding you know, center islands and things like that. So when I say complete redesign, I'm not talking about doing big things at intersections and stuff. I'm talking about, you know, I mean, that the changing the streetscape, which is a long-term thing. And that's kind of, I think, what people are looking at other than the changing of the culture. I think the education campaign, getting back to what David was saying about the drivers, I don't know how many times I've been standing at those same intersections, but in places where there's very visible intersections and multiple cars go by before they stop. And when you think about somebody who's disabled or elderly, moving a little slower, a child, you have to be really bold and sort of step out and kind of make them stop for you. And that that just shouldn't be. We need to create, you know, Kevin Maloney talked about sort of the culture that happens in Northampton. Somebody steps off and they stop. And that's the culture that we need to create. And it's, you know, yes, we need to step up enforcement, but it's a whole education campaign around, you know, the pedestrian, you know, you got to stop for pedestrians no matter what. Stop. And that has to be ingrained in our culture. There are other places where that exists, and it just has to happen. So I hope that that's going to be part of what the education campaign is.
Any further discussion about pedestrian safety at this time? The next item on the agenda is select board goals. We talked a little bit about the process, and we have a list of select board goals that's been presented. Does anybody have any comments on the list as presented?
I wanted to tweak one of them.
Okay.
Sorry, I got that later.
Yeah, no, I figured. Under increased town government accessibility and transparency, the third bullet, to change that to increased and diversified access for public participation. So not just increased of what we currently do, but also diversify different ways of that being available.
Dora?
Well, there's one thing that didn't make the list, and that was the issue of coming up with rites of passage and gifts for... Were you including that under staff culture and diversity?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Just making sure. Mm-hmm.
I would ask... under the second bullet, under increased town government accessibility and transparency, mm-hmm. that we talk about consider alternative means of participating, not identification of alternate means of participating. I make that suggestion because I'm a little concerned about what is or is not going to be acceptable and allowable under these circumstances. Mm-hmm. We had some concern expressed earlier in the year about anonymous participation, and I want to make sure that we are looking at it more thoroughly rather than just saying identify ways. So I'd rather just have it say consider ways if that's acceptable.
I think actually consider makes better sense because consider it doesn't just say you're looking at it means you're going to act on it. So
are there any other changes that are suggested, or does anybody have any concern with the changes that have been identified?
We'll make those changes and get them back out.
Well, then I move to approve the select board goals as presented. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed? That motion carries 4-0. The next matter on the agenda is committee appointments. We need to appoint representatives to the Wyndham Solid Waste Management District.
Do we have a motion?
I will move to reappoint Jane Southworth as the town's representative and Dora Bubalis as the town's alternate representative to the Wyndham Solid Waste Management District.
Is there any further discussion? Are there any other nominations? Dora?
No, I just want to say that the reason this comes up now is just because the way that they do their appointments, their calendar, and I think a long time ago it was because there were a lot of select board members who were representatives, and it went with that schedule.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anybody opposed? That motion carries 4-0. We're now to, Ken's got something he wants to say.
Just on correspondence.
All right, we're now to correspondence. Ken.
John, I would recommend that your memo be included with the next financial report so that Dick does not miss it, because I know he specifically wants that information.
Okay.
Everybody's had a chance to review.
Cut and paste it.
Everybody's had a chance to see the warrants. Barb, do you want to announce the meetings?
Yes, I can.
I'd love to do it last time.
Ken, please.
This is my new role. On Thursday, April 5th, 2012, the skate park committee meeting will be at 6 p.m. In the Hannah Kosman meeting room. On Monday, April 9th, at 5 p.m., the energy committee will be meeting in the Hannah Kosman room. At 6 p.m., the planning commission will be meeting in the select board meeting room. And also at 6 p.m., the Rec and Parks Board meeting is in the Gibson Aiken Center. Tuesday, April 10th, at 4:30 p.m., the Finance Committee will be meeting in the Hannah Kosman Room. And at 4:30 p.m., the Wastewater Treatment Plant Upgrade Oversight Committee will be meeting...
At the plant for a progress tour.
At the plant for a progress tour. Everyone is welcome to take a tour of the plant then. At 7 p.m., also on Tuesday the 10th, the Tree Advisory Committee will be meeting. Tree Advisory Committee will be meeting in the Hannah Kosman Room. Friday the 13th at 10 a.m., the ADA Advisory Committee will be meeting in the Marlboro College Graduate Center in the VCIL Conference Room. Also at 10 a.m. on Friday, it's the quarterly bar owner meeting in the Hannah Kosman meeting room. Skipping ahead to Monday the 16th at 7 p.m., the Development Review Board will be meeting in the Select Board meeting room. On Tuesday the 17th at 4 p.m., the Town Arts Committee will be meeting. At 5:15, the Citizens Police, is that what that is? The CPCC?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Citizens Police. Communication Committee will be meeting at the Vermont Partnership for Fairness and Diversity at 214 Main Street. And at 6:15 p.m., the Select Board will have its next regularly scheduled meeting.
Before we entertain a motion to adjourn, I want to thank Leela for participating and watching the whole meeting. It was good to have you here. I hope you found it interesting. We're ready for a motion to adjourn. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed? We're adjourned.
You forget to do abstention for
what's that?